What is up, everyone, and welcome to Chop Talk, our first episode where we just pick a topic about wrestling and we talk about it. I'm your host, Melball Collins, who just hit her puppy in the face, and to my right here, I've got Andre. Andre, how you doing today?
I am doing great. I'm ready to talk some local independent wrestling, and I'm really excited to talk. Our final topic for today is going to be a big one. So,
oh, yes. Drama coming out from the WWE yesterday. We don't want to miss out talking about that because that was shots fired.
Very much so.
Yeah. As you mentioned, we are here to review some local professional wrestling. But first, let's also introduce our little co-host here. We have little Kojima, who's going to be offering up absolutely nothing but adorableness and cuteness and maybe occasional kisses when mom gets stressed out. So without further ado, let's get into reviewing our first local wrestling that happened last week. That would be Top Talent Wrestling Academy's funded. It's a Slobberknocker. And man, was it ever. Andre, overall, how did we feel about the show?
I came out of that night going, man, this is we went 2 months ago to the first show they did, which was just a hell of a show. And I came out of this thing and they topped themselves. And that first show was so good. I was like, you don't think they can top themselves, but they did. They really did.
They did live up to their name. Hey, Top Talent. They stepped up and they showed up. Let's get into some of the matches that we got to enjoy last Thursday, featuring obviously the newly named Harlan Abbott, Mitch Clark, and of course Ava freaking Lawless. We opened up the show with Dalton Rogue. You know, I'm not gonna lie, that name confused me a little bit. I kept calling him Rouge, Dalton Rouge. I feel like roll off the tongue a little bit better.
His name is a play for the theme song he's got called Rogue Time. So Dalton Rogue Time. So yeah.
Because like he kind of gave me like Gambit vibes with his name. So I was like, ooh, Rouge is very Cajun. But
it's Rogue.
Dalton Rogue versus T.Y. Jackson, who of course was the winner last show of the briefcase, who now gets to challenge for the title, the newly crowned title that was crowned.
I guess it's a Money in the Bank situation.
I thought it was just
for a title shot. I didn't think it was meant for like you can cash in, as we will find out later on this show.
We will. And what a match these two had. I mean, T.Y. Jackson, he's already been known around here for having some incredible matches. The guy has really showed up, especially post-COVID, and he is earning a lot of good opportunities around here. This match was all over the place, all over the ring. Dalton, I gotta say, he's a strong kid. I don't know how old he is, but like, as a lady, that was
early 20s. Because I remember watching him in MPW years ago, and when he was first there, he was under 18. I know that. Again, everything was legal. His parents signed permissions. It was all good. But yeah, he was under 18 when he first started. So I think he's only in his early 20s right now. And like, he has really stepped up. And like the power bombs, he did like, was it like two or three power bombs in a row? Mm-hmm. And just the power on this kid is amazing. But in the end, T.Y. with his swanton does take the win.
But not without a lot of effort. I mean, look at how he's pinning him. He got beat down, but of course, he's a briefcase winner for a reason.
Yeah, he hit it and just flopped back and laid on him, and it was over. But it was a hell of a match. Like, it was a great opener, like high intensity. Mm-hmm. Both these guys have great in-ring ability. Both have great like high flying aspects. Both have power, like especially out of Dalton. Like his hard hitting is just amazing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and then from there we went to the women's match of the night.
The queen of Alberta, women's wrestling, Kat Von Hees. I love this woman. Such a beautiful woman. Such a talented woman. And my goodness, what a strong woman. And she was going up against the new contender here, Riley Rose. Is her name?
Yeah, Riley Rose.
And right new there. Gear for Riley. Look at that gear. I love that. That is an incredible look on her. The colors. Well,
she had amazing. That's completely new gear for the show. She had different gear. Was a couple months ago at the last show. So
yeah, she's
already rocking into her second set of gear. So
keep it up, girl.
Yeah, and it's high. It's good quality gear too. So that's mm-hmm. the best thing, because a lot of people you see early on in their careers, their gear quality can be a little bit lower, but like mm-hmm. her gear quality from even her other gear was really very nice. So yeah,
100%. And you want to come out looking like a professional at all times when you are being a professional wrestler. Both these girls have had an evolution of gear throughout their careers, regardless of if it's Kat or Riley. And Kat's gear, I also have to say, is at the best it's been in a couple of years. This is actually one of my favorite outfits of hers, because it just shows off every asset that she has.
Yeah, very much so. So we get into the match. We got a couple highlight spots here. Like, this is a lucky camera angle, just getting after Kat, whipped her into the turnbuckle. Just like a lucky shot. Just mm-hmm. the perfect impact shot. But yeah, I would say I got to get that one. So,
and we were right at ringside having such a blast.
Yeah, the seats we got were VIP awesome. Plus, in my opinion.
Absolutely. And then just randomly to throw out there, to see Benoit there in line with us was pretty shocking. Did you notice him throughout the night?
Who?
David Benoit.
Oh, he was there?
Yeah.
I did not see him, sorry to say. I really did not. Yeah. I was very, once we got in there, I was very focused on the wrestling when we got in there. And then finish came after a really good match between the two. Don't get me wrong, like, Riley is really showing, even two, mm-hmm. 3 months into her career, is really showing how good she is. Because I think her debut match was at the last Top Talent show, right?
Uh-huh, where she picked up a win over Taryn from Accounting.
Yeah, and then here she comes up against the true women's veteran in this province, Kat Von Hees. But Kat Von Hees coming out on the win with the implant buster, as you can see there, and the impact of it. But yeah, like, these two, I think, had a really, really strong match. Riley looking like she's been doing this for a while. I think she's got really good timing, and she's only going to get better.
Sorry, the puppy is noticing other puppies outside right now.
okay, yeah.
What a great match this was, to just add on to what it was you said. They went for quite some time also. The ring, and Riley was able to keep up with Kat for the most part, but at the end, like you said, the implant buster caught her off guard, and there it was.
Yeah, I think, Kat showing her veteran experience and her true ability in that ring to pick up that win. It's very, very good match, and I look forward to seeing, again, I love Kat Von Hees, loved her to death, love her for a long time, and I always want to see more from her, and I can't wait to see what comes next for Riley Rose either.
So. You can call her the unofficial United Empire Queen.
Okay. From here, we are going to a triple threat big man match featuring Azrael, Jesse Youngblood, and Raiden the Destroyer. So we got a couple highlights here, like just some great action shots, but I love seeing Azrael back. I've always been a big fan of him. I've gotten to know him over the years, and like, he's cracked me up at a few shows when sitting in the crowd with us that we'll talk about maybe in a couple weeks on why, though. But yeah, he has his return these last couple months with RCW, and actually the Top Talent when he came out and chokeslammed Mitch Clark through a table, I think it was. Was it Mitch Clark or who? I can't remember. Or no, it was the comedian guy
who
put through.
Yeah, it was the influencer guy who came out and insulted all of the people and then got in. Yeah,
the guy from Danger Cats. Yeah, but I really enjoyed the fact that he had Azrael coming back. And then Big Jesse Youngblood, I can't say a bad word about this guy in the ring. He is so good. He flies like he's a good 150 pounds lighter than he is. Mm-hmm. And when he can do a moonsault like nobody's business, he has a couple, like his suicide dives, his, like, just some of the stuff that this man does for a guy as big as he is unbelievable. Mm-hmm. And then you got Raiden the Destroyer, who is only about a year. I've only been seeing about on the scene here for about a year or so, maybe.
I think about a year and a half, almost two.
Yeah, somewhere in that. And yeah, he's been really, really improving a lot over the year we saw. And he had a really great showing with these guys.
Mm-hmm.
And but in the end, Jesse Umlund with the Michinoku driver getting the pin on Raiden the Destroyer.
And you can see the shock and awe on the best announcer in Western Canada there, back there. What about Ivan? Oh, my God.
It's only because I retired.
Facts. Hard facts. I don't remember if you remember Allie right next to us saying, man, the floor is shaking every time these guys do something.
Oh, yeah. It was
absolutely
nuts.
Incredible.
I could feel it in the floor. These are three super heavyweights. Like, they all are weighing in at 300 or more pounds. Mm-hmm. It was shaking the floor. It was crazy.
It was amazing. So here, what a match!
So from here, we got. Is this where I don't have pictures of it, but is this where the students came out? I think.
Oh yes, yeah. And they had their little interaction with Larry the Lumberjack, who had some.
Yeah, I don't know if it was right here or after the next match, but yeah, Ivan brought the six trainees out from the Top Talent Wrestling Academy, and they gave them their certificates for completing their training school time there. Again, you're always training and always getting better as you go. Look at Gigi Ray, man. But you've got so many. And then Larry comes up to interrupt it all, starts attacking them all, but then he gets his ass beat. It was great to see. Larry, I love the guy, but you weren't so rad that night.
No, not so rad when you're crawling your way out into the wrong area, too. I think he ended up going into the crowd instead of back up the ramp. And considering he just insulted a crap ton of people, probably was the not right way to go on that one.
Yeah. Yeah, very much so. And so from there, we go to Mitch Clark taking on the person he was supposed to be taking on was actually supposed to be Davey Richards, but he couldn't make his flight up that day. So in his replacement, we got the Lion Warrior, Bobby Sharp, showing up. And these two had a heck of a match. We only got a couple shots for this. There's a couple of the suplexes, just showing the power off for both of these men. Mm-hmm. But especially if you look at Bobby, man, he's only recently returned from hip surgery, having his hip replacement surgery. Yeah, so there's a lot of people who don't ever come back from having hip replacement and things like that. The fact that Bobby Sharp has come back and being as good as he is, and look, and just the incredible shape he's been in. Mm-hmm.
Almost arguably in better shape than before his surgery.
Yeah, I was going to say, Bobby was always in good shape, but he is so cut, and his cardio is on point, especially for guys only been back for a couple months now. His cardio is on point. Like, you don't see that guy slowing down in that ring. I also got to shout out Mitch Clark. I'm a huge fan of the guy. I've been a fan since his MMA days. And again, being a Canadian boy, I get behind pretty much any Canadian that's in the UFC. But Mitch, I've gotten to know him over the last few years here working in MPW, then RCW, now with Top Talent and Love Pro. I think this guy has only evolved and only getting better. His mannerisms, he gets everybody to hate him so well. I think he's just he's evolving so well as a performer, and I think he is only upside for this guy going forward. But in the end, Mitch did get the win by pinning Bobby Sharp with off the second rope, a doctor bomb off the second rope, a gotcha wrench power bomb essentially off the second rope. Very impressive from both these men, yeah.
Absolutely. Very rough landing on that one, too. As soon as that happened, I was like, no, we just got him back. Don't take away our Bobby Sharp. This was actually the reason why I tweeted out that Davey Richard looks suspiciously a lot like Bobby Sharp tonight.
Yeah, but they have a similar build. So, yeah. And so from here, we're going on – to honestly one of my favorite matches of the night, and it was the Omen, Gabriel Lestat, taking on Nasty Nate Nixon. And man,
everywhere we go.
I have that song on my phone. I that song is in regular rotation on my phone since he first debuted.
Likewise.
in RCW, it's been in my phone on his rotation once I found what that song was. It's just I love it so much.
But it is a great song.
These two, like, and it's a clash of styles in a sense, but it's also like. If you look at Omen, he's got a very like lucha based style, but with a strong style influence. And then Nate is very much influenced by that striking strong style, in my opinion.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Nate may have a different opinion on that, but I see when I see him wrestle. But
no, I thought you're absolutely right.
I don't know. Is this the first time they've faced, or have they faced in RCW?
It is. This is actually the first time that the Omen and Nate have actually stepped in the ring in any capacity together to wrestle. Something that I actually wanted to touch on, what you just mentioned, is Nate does tend to have an almost exclusively strike and ground-based kind of wrestling, in that he's not typically jumping around, he's not typically pulling out stunts, whereas, as you mentioned, the Omen does have that lucha tendency after training in Mexico for a few months. But what I did notice, and I don't know if you caught this at that end of the match, right before the finish, Nate's just throwing everything he had at the Omen, and then out of nowhere, he pops up and does a hurricanrana. I didn't even know Nate had the capacity to do a hurricanrana, let alone to just pull one out against someone who's specifically trained to counter it. And I think it took Omen by surprise, which is why it actually got pulled off, and he actually almost pinned the Omen at that point. Omen couldn't kick out of the pin. He actually just had to put his foot on the rope. But thankfully, obviously Omen supporter here, he did manage to pull off a win in there. And what a show of sportsmanship handshake.
When I saw Omen get the pin, I kind of thought back to the G1 we were reviewing just recently. I can't remember which match it was, but Shingo Takagi pulled somebody down into almost like a sliding clutch into the pin. Omen seemed to have a very similar pin in what I was watching there. So
might have been a little influential there.
Yeah, there we go.
I mean, Shingo Takagi, as you mentioned, he is the dragon. Vlad Dracul, Dracula, was the dragon himself. I mean, comparisons galore. Maybe. Maybe.
But from here, we're going to move on to the six way scramble match for the Top Talent Wrestling Championship, and it featured. I don't have that graphic up, do I? Oh no, I don't have that graphic.
That's okay.
It had all the people in the match. We can go from
left to right. We got the beautifully talented Ava Lawless on the far left there. She's being barked at by the hillbilly hound dog Draco. We got Colton Kelly squatting down in the corner there. You got Dean Richter, the Power Ranger, in the yellow shin pads there.
Hey, Pokemon trainer extraordinaire. Pokemon trainer extraordinaire. He has
wants
come up
to be the very best.
When he is introduced, he's always introduced from a different from every different Pokemon gym city. So he is a Pokemon trainer extraordinaire, in my opinion.
And then, of course, we had the white shirt. I don't remember what his name was.
Oh, I had it. I don't have a name. I apologize, white shirt. But that guy impressed the heck out of me. Like, he was the biggest surprise of this match for me. Sorry, I'm just looking for his name right now.
Considering how worked he got by Mitch Clark in the first one, but he did keep up very, very well with Clark in that first one. You remember the Clark actually fought
William Taylor.
Three opponents, was the last one. William Taylor, is it?
Yeah, white shirt William Taylor. I apologize, sir. But I thought, guys, we have only seen him in the squash from last time. I was very impressed by this man, and it was my first time seeing him. And I think this is my first time seeing Hillbilly Hound Dog Draco. And I'm very perplexed by a certain redneck karate that he does, where he ends up hitting people in the balls at the end of it all. So, yeah.
That sounds very Briscoe. Very Briscoe. Yeah, it was very
redneck karate, in my opinion, what he was doing in parts of the match. But we had a great match overall. Like, Colton and Ava, I think, to me, the two true standouts in this match, because just because of how good both of them are, and that is not to disregard any of the other competitors. I find Colton steals a lot of steals a show in a lot of matches, and Ava does the same thing. And I think they both really did in this.
Mm-hmm.
And then
I have to agree. So, Colton has been on a steady incline especially since COVID. He's just come out swinging and he's hitting all his marks. I'm very proud of him and the progress that he has made, especially in the last couple of years.
Yeah. And then this picture right here in particular, I was very impressed because Mars would literally sit up out of the space he was in and suplex both these men into the ring.
Mm-hmm.
And just the power off that man. How and no sign of him. He is a small individual.
Mm-hmm.
And honestly, maybe he's got maybe two, three inches on Ava, and Ava's on the smaller side too. Mm-hmm. For a small man, that guy's got power, speed. I think he's got the whole package in him. But yeah, mm-hmm. And then
deceptively strong that one.
Ava looking just intense as always. Like, just a beautiful shot from whoever the camera person for this was.
I believe this picture actually came from our good friend Eric Graves, who provided us a lot of these pictures that we're using. Shout out to Eric.
Eric, thank you very much, Eric, for all the wonderful pictures. There's a mix between mine, Mel's, and Eric's in the top talent pictures for sure. But yeah, it's just wonderful. Especially, I got to shout out Ava, man. Like, her abilities have just been so good. So good. And then capping off, getting the pin on, I'm pretty sure it was Hound Dog Hillbilly Draco. Oh, no. It was Mars. No, I have it written down here. No. Ava won after spearing and pinning Mars. So, yeah, it was Mars that it took the pin. I thought it was Draco, but I got confused. But I got to look at my notes more. That's the main thing. I got to look at my notes more instead of just assuming things.
But, and again, what a show of sportsmanship from Colton Kelly afterwards, celebrating the champion.
Oh, yeah. Like, put her over huge because, again, Colton grew up in this business. He knows how hard people have to work to succeed in this business, and he knows how hard she has worked. Mm-hmm. But it's about three years now she's been in this business. Two. Almost, it'd be three in December, yeah. Because she debuted at the Clandestine Show. She has worked so hard for this, and just such a different style, and has really, really captured Alberta professional wrestling and a lot of different places where she goes too.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm very happy to see her win this match.
Yeah, didn't she just come off of a match against Killer Kelly in Defy?
I'm not sure, to tell you the truth.
She was just in Defy. I just don't remember. I want to say it was Killer Kelly. I think it was Killer Kelly that she just took.
Yeah, I'm
regardless, not. Good for her. Congratulations, girl.
Very much so. And then we go to the main event of the evening. It is Gringo Loco, GCW Superstar. A man I am insanely a fan of. Like, I got, and at intermission, he was out selling merchandise. I went to meet him, and he had hats. So I was like, I got to buy a hat. I love getting hats from wrestlers. And he said it was the first hat he sold of these hats, because he had literally got them shipped to his door the day before just before he flew up here. So I got the first hat off the batch. So I'll say I'm proud of that. And then making his re-debut in a sense, the healer Harlan Abbott, formerly, I guess, murdered Heavy Metal.
Heavy goddamn Metal is somewhere in the BC wilderness.
He's drowned in a stream, isn't he? I saw that video. I so
The Bears check are looking social media for hibernation season, so maybe we won't find.
That being said,
though, I mean, look at his gear. What an incredible step up from his old gear. Corset crotch. I'm getting sick of corset crotch on everyone.
But
what a match.
These two were on fire. Just the spots galore. And then we don't have the picture of it, but a bunch of the trainees were at ringside with us watching the show. Mm-hmm. And Harlan Gringo ended up rolling out of the ring to get away from Harlan and was out in the crowd right with the students. So Harlan decides to hop onto the top rope, you can see the gap. I don't know, it's not super clear in any of these pictures, but there you can see where the person's drink is.
There's about a 4 or 5 foot
gap to the ring, and that's down lower than the floor we're on.
Mm-hmm.
And Harlan proceeds to do a springboard like swanton out of the ring into the crowd onto the trainees and Loco, and from what I heard, ended up kicking Riley Rose's mom in the face by accident.
Square in the face. I actually saw that. Her hair just went flying and everything. I was like, no.
I felt she's a so trooper bad though.
That's where Riley gets her toughness.
Hey, her mom took her first bump in wrestling.
She got to learn somehow, right? And also, Harlan also did, before that, a tope suicida directly in front of us onto Gringo far and so hard that he actually hit that barricade.
He ended up hitting the barricade, and it was just we were just like, is he okay? He hit Loco full on, but the amount of power that Metal had going, literally, he hit Loco. Loco went down, but he went right into that barricade. It was just... Mm-hmm.
We felt that vibration, and we're not even attached to it.
Yeah, but in the end, the healer, Harlan Abbott, did pick up the win with a 450 splash onto Gringo Loca. And the show of respect after that, both men raised each other's hands. They shook hands, and very, very, very wonderful main event to send us off for the night. Yeah.
And, of course, afterwards, Beercade was hosting the after party in which a lot of the wrestlers did show up to kind of hang out afterwards. I was lucky enough to be there, have a few shots with the guys. What a good night. What a way to end the night.
I really should have went. I really should have. But I ended up somewhere else hanging out with a friend of mine. So, yeah.
I'm not going to lie. If it gets down to it, the after party was planned almost less than a week before the actual show. Going forward, I think it would be smarter for the manager who organized it to give everybody at least 2 to 3 weeks notice that the event is going to happen, just because it gives people the opportunity. It is a Thursday. You know, some people work Fridays and can't justify staying out that late because they have to go home.
Yeah.
It gives them a chance to find coverage, save maybe a little extra money to ensure that they can drink a little bit at the bar. You know, just a little bit more organization on that side. But honestly, what a great night.
Yeah, honestly, I had a blast. Like top end show for top talent pro wrestling. Like, I had a great time. And as long as my finances are in order, I will be back for their October 6th show, Tougher Than a $2 Steak.
Is that what it's called?
I think that's what Ivan kept saying, Tougher Than a $2 Steak, over and over again. Hey. So I assume that's the name of the show. But
creativity right there.
Thursday, October 6th, if you are in the Edmonton region, in the Alberta area, or even surrounding provinces, and you can make the trip in for a Thursday, October 6th, I highly recommend you come out for that show, because I loved it. And if I can feasibly afford it, because I have some big expenses coming up over September,
you're going, sir. This isn't an option. You're going.
Work is all also involved.
Well, one way or another, we're getting you into this show. I don't care if I need to smuggle you, kidnap you, sneak you in, bribe security. you're coming in.
Yeah. So from here, I got to go to a show on Friday night the following day, and it was Love Pro Wrestling. So Mel's going to step off the side because she wasn't at the show. And honestly, I had a wonderful, wonderful time at this show. Like, I have yet to be disappointed by a Love Pro Wrestling show. I go to them regularly. They're the last Friday of every month. Their next show is September 30th. Yes. And I highly recommend you go out if you haven't been to it. And I convinced a couple of my friends to come back to going to pro wrestling, to coming to independent pro wrestling last month, to come to a Love Pro Wrestling show. And it paid off at this show because it's LPW and Out Come the Wrestlers. We had a great card, and it started out with the wonderful Veda Scott. They are a true awesome in professional wrestling, and they do a great job at the commentary booth. And they took on Taryn from accounting, which in the end, Taryn with her Houston hangover, I can't remember what it's called, when you hop over somebody, grab them and smash your head into a mat, takes him down for the 1-2-3. But right after that, a man named Magnificent Mitch Clark would make his way out with his manager, I want to call him. I don't know what to call him anymore. The Judge Ben Omen. And he would challenge TFA to a championship match for her championship. And she accepted on the spot right then and there. And within a few minutes, Mitch Clark took down TFA, who was already worn down from wrestling Veda Scott, and was not very fair for TFA. I think she deserves a rematch at this point because she needs to have a fair shot back at her title. But Mitch Clark submitting TFA with the Cobra Clutch, and as magnificent as he is, I guess he was pretty rad that night. As he got the win, got a title. But not on the most fair way, in my opinion. And just to shout out, all the pictures we have for Love Pro Wrestling are courtesy of Love Pro Wrestling. And thank you very much for supplying us the photos for this, so we could put them in the show today. The next match, the rest of the Rads would come out to celebrate, and Ben Omen decided, well, if we're going to be on this card, we're going to have our match now. So the Rads, they ended up taking on Burak Rani, and was supposed to be Sheik Shabazz, but she decided to go on a trip and be away in another country for some weird-ass reason. And so the night, Dr. Kyoto ended up paying the Thickness, Reed Matthews, to join him as his tag team partner. And honestly, wonderful match between the four of these. I always love seeing Thickness in this match because his style is just pure hard-hitting power, but with some crazy speed for a bigger man. And in the end, there was some confusion, and the Rads ended up getting the snapshot, as M&M used to call it, on Burak Rani getting the win. And the Rads get to celebrate two wins tonight, which is just slightly disappointing because I don't think they're that rad, but eh. Well, from here, Zoe Sager would come out to cut a promo and tell us some stuff about how she was not feeling professional wrestling, and that maybe she loves it, but she isn't sure she can do it anymore. And then Gigi would come out to interrupt her and would try to give her a pep talk and tell her, We're that good. They're both that good. They both have places they can go, or to places to go up and up. And Zoe would come back and tell her that no, she was there to keep wrestling, and would reveal, if you see the in the come back out, to reveal that he is now her bodyguard. And they would attack Gigi and beat her down, but they would get run off, and their match would come up tonight in the main event, and I'm excited to talk about that one. But up next, we had the Fatal 4-Way winner-take-all match, when that whoever won this match would get a shot at Michael Richards Blaze's LPW Grand Championship. You have Sean Moore, who has just recently returned from Mexico. He's been there for about 3-4 months, just killing it down there. If you got to see any of the video he's been sharing, it's great. You had the man of two minds, Jack Pride, and you had one of my favorites, the Son of Irish, and these guys just killed it. Son of Irish is just insane in some of the things he does. But Sean Moore, I got a shout out. Like, his wrestling ability before he left for Mexico was bar none some of the best technical wrestling in this province. And I think he's only gotten better and better while adding a little bit of lucha flavor to his style. But in the end, Son of Irish would go for a shooting star press. I think it was on to Sean Moore. Maybe it was Travis. I can't remember. And then after he hit it, as he was going for the pin, it was the top one. Pride would come out of nowhere and curb stomp Irish and then roll Irish over and get the pin, steal the win from Irish. And next month, it looks like your main event's going to be Michael Richard Blaze and Jack Pride for the LPW Grand Championship. I think I'm looking very much looking forward to that. After this four-way, that match is probably going to be quite the banger. And from there, we go to our fifth match of the night. It is Bobby Sharp, who we just talked about on the Top Talent Wrestling Show that was on the day before, taking on my good friend, Mel's good friend, everybody's good friend, Chris Parrish. And the man who I love this gentleman. He has done just so much good stuff in professional wrestling. And there's a shot from him on his entrance. I just love it so, so much. I'm such a big fan of Chris Parrish, and like just him and Bobby, like I said with Bobby, his ability in that match was, he's so, so good. And I can't stop talking about these, like Bobby coming back from what he's come back from. It's amazing. And then Chris Parrish, who has been out for the last couple of months dealing with nagging injuries and stuff like that, coming back. And these two, I think they've been wrestling each other for at least 15 years or so, because again, Bobby came up in Monster Wrestling where in the same place that Chris Parrish came in. So they've known each other for so long and they've wrestled each other for so long. And I just really, really, really want to shout this match out. But in the end, Bobby did score a quick roll-up on Chris Parrish to get the win. Kind of a roll-up out of nowhere. And it was good to see, good match to see, and I highly recommend it checking it out on the Love Pro Wrestling Twitch page. From here, when we returned from intermission, we got Michael Richard Blaze and Stephen Crow, the Clandestine Society, against making their LPWW State of Emergency. And I've never seen State of Emergency wrestle before outside of a few YouTube videos that I've gotten to watch of them. I was very impressed with them. Miles DeVille and Sebastian Wolf. This match probably it's tied for my match of the night. It was these guys just couldn't stop. One of the spots, Stephen Crow was out kind of in the balcony or just off the ring. There's a balcony there, and he ended up climbing onto his brother and hitting a hurricanrana off the top rope to Miles DeVille, and just it was crazy. The end came with Clandestine Society hitting the Magic Killer, I can't remember which member of SOE it was, and getting the win. So wonderful match. I love this match, but I got to give a shout out to Michael Richard Blaze, because before this match, when they were coming out for their entrance, I was sitting at a table in the VIP section with my buddy Ryan and Amanda. And Ryan and Amanda only had just recently, like was last show they came back to Steam First Wrestling. It's the first time since before the pandemic. And Blaze sees Ryan. He just makes a beeline into the VIP area and just comes up and gives him a hug and thanks him for coming back. Because me and Ryan have always been big, big Michael Richard Blaze fans. And I really was taken aback with Blaze running up to thank Ryan for coming back. Because me and Ryan, we've always been big supporters of Blaze. And I know Blaze appreciated Ryan coming back. And I know Ryan really appreciated Blaze coming up and giving him that big old hug. So from that match, we went on to Adam Ryder versus Michael Allen, Richard Clark. I thought these two just had a banger. The crowd was a little quiet in the beginning, but I think coming back from intermission, you always are. But these two had this crowd eating out of the palm of their hands by the end of this thing. And in the end, Adam Ryder did get the win with a code breaker and followed up by a Pele kick for the win. And these guys just constantly kill it. Michael Allen, Richard Clark, I've been watching for years, just kill it up, kill it. Adam Ryder, I've only been seeing his stuff on YouTube, but every time I watch him, phenomenal. And finally get to see him wrestle in person, I was very, very impressed by this man. From there, we went on to another tag team match featuring Mo Jabari and his partner, Mars the Specialist, who you can't see because he's behind the camera in the picture. Taking on the Voros Twins, who I'm a very big fan of. Check them out on Twitch, Insta, anywhere you can do social media. I think they are the most followed professional wrestlers on Twitch that aren't signed to a major company. So impressive stat. But in the end, the Voros do get the win. But again, it comes as a fact of the masked man who has been torturing Mo Jabari with showing up and screwing him over with matches and putting videos coming up. I think Spencer Love needs to invest in some serious malware protection and better security to his to the computer systems they use for the videos and stuff. Because if he can keep hacking into this, that's getting scary there, Spenny. But I don't know, buddy. But overall, I really enjoyed it. I always love seeing the Voros Twins. And Mo Jabari and Mars, it seems to be getting contentious because this is, the third time in a row that they've lost a match because of the masked man. So this team of Mars and Mo might not be there for the long run, which just makes me a bit sad. But from here, we are going to go to the main event of the evening. And it is going to be Gigi Rae taking on Zoe Sager. Gigi from Millwoods, Alberta, right here in Edmonton. She was so over with this crowd. She has been appearing on AEW Dark, AEW Dark Elevation. She's been on AEW Dynamite itself. And she has been getting over so well in the world of professional wrestling. This crowd was so behind her, especially after the promo with Zoe turning her back on Gigi. And just, I thought these two women went out and had one of the best, and not to to sound sexist, but one of the best women's matches I've ever watched in my life. And like I said, this is tied for my match of the night. Like, it's really hard for me to choose between this and the clandestine versus SOE match, but this might just take it because, like, the crowd, that how much they were into this, the back and forth between both of these women, it was just so intense. And I absolutely love this match. And Zoe did get the win with her X Factor style move. But Gigi, after the match, would cut a promo saying she thanked everybody for showing up, thanked all her family and friends that showed up, and all the fans that showed up to support her. And she said she's going to keep killing it in professional wrestling. And you can just see so many people on their feet clapping for her after such an amazing match. She had the crowd eating up palm of her hands. But overall, I have to say, this match, this whole show was just a awesome, awesome show. I highly recommend to come out to the next Love Pro Wrestling show, which is on September 30th. You can get your tickets at Love Pro, through Love Pro Wrestling's Facebook page. The ticket link is there. And I'm going to bring my co-host Mel back in. Just got to unmute her mic. I tried to.
Oh, man, what a day.
I tried to unmute it for you, but it didn't work.
Gotta keep pay attention to what I'm doing here. So, awesome. What an incredible weekend for wrestling. Two amazing shows. There were more, but we just...
There were shows in Lethbridge. There were shows in Saskatchewan. There were shows... I think one in Medicine Hat, too.
Like they're all.
Yeah, RCW ran, I think, Lethbridge and Medicine Hat over the weekend. Mm-hmm. Like it's just wrestling is just exploding here in Alberta, and you can't ask for anything better, in my opinion.
Except for more money, so that I can afford to go to all of them.
Yeah, I need more money too. I need a raise of work.
And more money for the guests to get to those shows. Because gosh dang.
Yeah. Go ahead, Mel. Sorry.
No. I was just going to segue into our next topic here, which is going to be our official Chop Talk. And that is going to be the situation that happened last night, which I'm sure everyone's still talking about. Situation between Matt Riddle, Seth Rollins promo on Raw. Andre, is this a work? Or is this a shoot? Was this a legit shot that Seth Rollins decided to take at Matt Riddle? Was this Triple H? Is Triple H's scent all over this?
Yeah, it's very much. I think it was planned in a sense that Triple H has, if you look at Triple H's heyday, in his day, everybody was allowed to cut their own promos from bullet points. Like you knew they knew their topics coming out, but like it's really raw. So I got some video here that does deal with this thing. I'm going to show you first what spawned the
language description advised.
Well, I'm going to show you what spawned what initially spawned their sit down interview section, and it is that they did get into almost into an altercation in the parking lot before the show. There was a fan cam that caught it.
Let's just talk about, first of all, how filthy Riddle's feet are going to be when he gets into that building. Man.
Oh, dude, the fact he's not wearing shoes anywhere is bothering the crap out of me.
Everyone knows I'm a big New Japan fan and Japanese wrestling fan in general. WWE is not something I watch on a regular basis. I only watch the pay-per-views and usually with you at Beercade. So for me, I can't tell. Just based on my recent experience, I can't tell if that was a work or if that was a shoot or what. The addition of the referees would tell me this is probably a shoot. I would assume that while the wrestlers are showing up at the venue, that the referees would be in the same kind of casual dress that the wrestlers are going to be in. And no offense to anything, but like, I don't think Seth Rollins travels in that outfit. I don't think he travels in a sparkling gold suit. So
the dude has quite the big head these days, so I wouldn't be surprised if he travels in a sparkly gold suit at this point.
Hey, maybe he does. I mean, like I said, I don't watch the product, so I'm not going to be a really good opinion on that. But for me, I was just very amused by the fact that Jamie Noble's in there trying to push off Seth Rollins. And it's like, dude, is like a chihuahua trying to stand up to a Great Dane, man.
Like, and again, this is from a few years back. Jamie Noble was part of Seth Rollins' security crew for a while there. And so, like, the fact I was like, oh, it's Noble trying to handle him back. I was just like, okay, but like, this has become like almost a blood feud. And like, I wasn't super sold on watching Clash at the Castle. But after seeing just this promo, nothing else on from Raw, don't worry, some other stuff helped drew me in, but this is what drew me in to want to watch Classic Castle clash at the castle.
Doing that five times fast.
Just to see these two go. So I'm like, they did get into a promo where they go back and forth, talk about some stuff. But then a couple minutes later, when they came back from commercial, the cameras caught a little bit more after the interview was over. And I'm going to play it for you now.
Please.
You talk about my family, man. Let's talk about your family. Oh, wait, you ain't got one because your wife divorced you and took your kids and they don't want to see your bitch ass anymore, huh?
What did you just say?
Yeah, you heard me.
Where are you?
Bitch.
Where are you?
I'm here. Come find me.
Dude, you don't get it. I'm not going to beat you up. I'm going to f*** you up, bro. Where the f*** are you?
All right,
Where are you?
Come find
Where
me,
Where is
bitch.
He? Come Where on. Are you? Dude, you don't get it. I'm going to smash your face in.
Okay, cool.
Yeah. Keep playing games, bro. Keep playing games. I'm going to f*** you up.
Just the intensity from Matt Riddle there was insane.
I don't think I've heard an F-bomb on WWE since the 90s.
Maybe early 2000s at best? Jeez.
Yeah, at best. And that's a stretch. That was a... Ooh. This is where I get confused on if that was a work or if that was a shoot. And if there's legit heat going on, because, you know, there's certain things that you do and that you know as a professional that you are allowed to include in certain things and that you are not allowed to include in certain things. What Seth Rollins brought up doesn't just bring up Riddle's family. It brings up the legal action and ramifications that initially started the divorce and the breakup of Matt Riddle and his wife. I would assume that Triple H, being a family guy himself, and especially in the situation that he's with, where he, you know, his wife is kind of the big
boss.
Cheese of the company.
She's the boss lady.
Yeah. If he was in that situation, I don't think he would want someone bringing up his wife or his children, regardless if they're still married or not. Yeah, for me, I'm like, oof, was that necessary?
The kids part, that's what really, like, took me back. Like, taking a shot at a guy for his wife leaving him is one thing.
Mm-hmm.
Like, stuff happens in relationships, people break up, things like that. But to take a shot at him and say, your wife and kids left you, and that his kids don't want anything to do with him anymore, that's what really was the part that was taken aback to me. And it was like, it seemed like it went a little far, but it got me to want to watch Clash at the Castle. I'm going to be end up watching. I got to work Saturday evening, but I'll end up watching it on late Saturday night or Sunday morning. And I'm interested. Like, they've got me. They really do.
Hook and sinker.
Very much so. But like, just, I don't, as much as this has been very interesting, but I don't want to see more and more promos getting into like these people's true family lives. Cause like eventually somebody's going to say something that went too far. And like, just an example of that, some of the backstage stuff we've been hearing at AEW, that Sammy cut a promo, was it 2-3 weeks ago? And it was taped for Rampage, so it ended up the stuff that he said was edited out. A lot of it was edited out that really pissed Eddie Kingston off. But he was calling him fat and taking a shot at his weight and those issues. And the more that this kind of stuff gets brought into professional wrestling, sometimes it can be like, in this case, they're getting really lucky that it's been a weirdly captivating part. But to some viewers, this stuff might go too far. So do you want to continue to take, do promotions want to continue to take risks like this? Because something may come out and they say something that's a personal thing that really turns a crowd off too. It could really turn somebody on, not on the person that's saying it, but it might turn on the person that's being said about some people might get really unhappy with some of this stuff. And I don't want to, I like realism being brought into professional wrestling. I think that the best professional wrestlers and their characters are the best, are enhanced versions of who they truly are. Mm-hmm. But when you start getting into personal lives and things like this, sometimes it can go too far. And we're lucky with this one. It's not gone too far yet. Mm-hmm. But we got to be careful. Mm-hmm. Where we go next? What is and again, this isn't, I don't say AEW copies WWE, but somebody is going to look at that promo and go, well, who's got something in the back? Who's got some kind of personal thing we can take a shot at? And if you just do it for taking a shot at sake, no. If a program warrants somebody getting really to dig in on somebody, I'll accept it. But not, like, I don't want...
Yeah. I have to agree. You can't be... delving too much into somebody's personal business, because the personal stuff is not necessarily who that person is. You know, sometimes wrestlers use their real names to wrestle, and I don't know if Riddle actually does or not, but like, when you become that character, you are that character, you are that gimmick, you are that person. That separates you entirely from your personal life. You know, I'm dating a wrestler, but I'm not dating the wrestler. I'm dating the guy who plays the wrestler. So, you know, how I act with him when he's in full character and gimmick versus how I interact with him when he's not are two completely different people. If somebody were to bring me into a situation, they don't want that. they just don't want that.
Yeah.
But it's also, it becomes a matter of people need to remember that even though they are trying to pick a fight or stab at a particular individual, if you're bringing other people into it, you are attacking those other people as much as you are attacking the individual. And that's something that they need to take into consideration, because you don't want to be attacking children. That's not very good, and that's kind of frowned upon in society right now. So
the other thing I'm looking at is, like, yes, it's his ex-wife, and maybe Matt Riddle, because again, we all know wrestling is scripted in the end. Mm-hmm. Maybe he gave the go ahead, but how does the ex-wife feel about this? Like, her dirty laundry's, the dirty laundry's out there. It became public knowledge, and this stuff's out there. But does she want herself and her children referenced on WWE programming? Yes, yeah, Seth Rollins, his wife is a wrestler there in the company. Everybody knows they have a child together. So bringing them up, you don't have an outside party, but. How does she feel being brought up in these kind of match, in these kind of things? That's the other thing you got to look at is there is somebody else in all this in Riddle's ex, and how does she feel on being brought up as part of a storyline and professional wrestling?
And then how is this also going to affect his children, who are obviously in school? And there's going to be kids in the school who watch the show, who know what's going on. And then they're going to go to these kids and be like, oh, you want nothing to do with your dad? Is that true? You know, how much is that going to negatively impact, again, not just Riddle, but the people who are still in his life, who are referenced and then are still really not active in his life? And again, of course, it does bring up those past allegations and ramifications for the allegations, which you would think the WWE in general would want to kind of steer away from, because those were some pretty serious allegations that did come out against him that did end up and result in his divorce from his wife.
Yeah, so it's just, you look at it and you just...
On a scale of 1 to 10, Andre, what do we think the violation, 1 being not so violated and 10 being violated, what do we think that was?
To Riddle, I put it more like a 3, but when it you but with having the wife involved, and I say more like a 5 or a 6 kind of area, because I don't think it's like way crossing the line like a 10 would be, but around a 5, because it's like, oh, he crossed the line and he brought some truly personal things into it that I look at and go, should it have happened? I just, like I said before, I just don't want this to become a trend in professional wrestling. And I just, I don't want people's true life dirty laundry. Like, yes, if somebody's stuff is truly public and the thing's going on and they are agreeing to using it as promos, but I just, yes, Riddle stuff is public, but his wife's life, his ex-wife's life is not public in a way. She's not a performer as far as I know. She could be, I don't know. But she's not, it doesn't seem like, she's not a well-known character like a Becky Lynch is. So I look at it for the outside as I don't want to see people's, like, if Matt Hardy's personal life got brought into something, that's one thing. His wife is a performer. She's a wrestler. She was a wrestler. She's very animated about everything. But like, if you just go and bring, if somebody's to bring Sting's wife, bring up Sting's wife or something, she's not involved in professional wrestling. But it's just those kind of things. You worry about how it affects the people that aren't a part of, that aren't actually professional wrestlers and performers, is where I look at that promo as an issue.
I 100% agree with you. I also equally hope that it is not something that becomes, here's like, it's regular in professional wrestling. You don't need to always get personal to cut a good promo. Not that we've seen a lot of promos lately, but
we've seen some better ones lately.
The quality of the ones that do come out are great because they're clearly putting thought into it. But I want to see more. I want to see particularly, local guys, the top talent guys, the LPW guys, girls. I want to see promos. You guys are, it's monthly or every 2 month shows. There's no reason why you can't entice me. There's no reason why you can't shoot something to introduce me to yourself. Who are you? Why do I care who you are? What are you doing? What are you capable of?
Especially if you're newer.
Exactly.
If you're newer. Like the top talent students, they're going to eventually get onto these cards and be wrestling. So I want to see them. Yeah, I would love to see them cut promos, talk about themselves. Yes, you're going to get posted on the Top Talent Facebook page and get it shared out through there and through the Twitter. But the fans follow those things and do it. I want to know who you are. I want to hear more things about you.
Mm-hmm. And the more promos you cut, the more people you are going to reach. And they're going to get people more interested, not just in the companies you're working for, but you as an individual. So that when you do share a poster that, hey, I'm going to be in Lethbridge. Hey, you know what? That might be a fairly long drive for me, but if I'm interested and I'm dedicated to you as a fan, I'm going to make that drive. But you have to make me that fan. And to make me that fan, actually wrestling is a part of that, but it is a small part of it. And another part is the promos. And like, we saw a pretty heckin' incredible promo put on by Harlan Abbott as he murdered heavy metal. The quality of production on that was dang near Hollywood quality. I thought I was watching a movie.
But again, I don't need to see Hollywood quality promos. If it was AEW or WWE or even like Impact or Major League Wrestling, that level, I want higher end production quality, even New Japan and Stardom, which we will talk about next week. And I have some comments about production quality for that company. A perfect example is Michael Richard Blaze. He likes to do a lot of videos. But he literally just has a black backdrop and he's cutting promos into a camera. But he sucks you in. He brings it. The quality is good. And when he does do other things for the video, he shoots them well. All you need, just give us a nice flat background and work into the camera and give us your passion. Tell us who you are. Tell us why we should care about you, and tell us why we want to see you, because that is going to bring me in more and more and more, and I will want to see you wrestle. It's just, but we want to, that's what I want to see from everyone and every spectrum of professional wrestling too, not just here. You want to be drawn in. That's a big problem I have with like AEW in ways that they introduce, especially through the New Japan. So I knew who they were, but I have friends who were watching AEW that, who, like my buddy Adam, he had no idea who most of the Japanese. He knew Tanahashi from, because of the name. He knew Okada because of the name. He knew Jay White. And he knew Will Ospreay because I talked to him about Will Ospreay. But he,
you talk about Will Ospreay? Never.
Every once in a while. Like, he no idea who they are. And that's where video and promo quality really makes a difference in professional wrestling. Tell me who you are, because that's going to make me care. Otherwise, you're just a guy doing moves.
Absolutely. And at this point in this day and age, there is literally zero excuse. You have one of these, you can do anything with this. You can record, you can edit, you can add things, you can choose the music. They have literally made this a mobile laptop, as well as a phone, as well as a dictionary, as well as a research thing. You can look up other people's promos and use it for yourself with your own thing. Just change it and put your own spin on it. There's absolutely zero excuse for there to be the desolate amount of promos that we have, particularly here in Alberta.
Again, I don't want to shit on the business, because I enjoy professional wrestling that I go to, but
100%.
A lot of, like, I don't, get me wrong, like, going to the Love Pro Wrestling show, State of Emergency has never worked in Love Pro Wrestling before. Yes, they worked in RCW, so they, some fans here are aware, but there's a lot of fans that go to Love Pro Wrestling that don't go to other shows. They posted a promo on, and Love Pro Wrestling shared it, talking about how they're coming, just talking about who they are. That's all you need to do. It doesn't need to be 10 minutes. It needs to be, even give me 30 seconds. I just, if you're not known, I want to know more about you. That's the biggest thing. I just want to know who I'm going in to watch a show. And that helps me so much more. So I don't sit there going, like, the only reason I knew White Shirt on the Top Talent show is because he had worked the show before, but I still don't know much about him. Do I want to know more? Yes, I really liked him, and I thought he did really, really well. But give us more. I want to see promos from people. And again, this is not us shitting on the business. We both love professional wrestling. We both love the independent scene we watch. Just the better informed fans are, the better professional wrestling is.
100%. 100%. Couldn't have said it better myself. The more you put yourself out there, the more people are going to know who you are. The more things that you do, the more following you're going to gain. The more following you gain, the more likely your companies that you're working for are going to be successful, because people are coming specifically to see you as an individual. And you're absolutely right. It's not me shitting on anybody. Everybody here is talented. There's just certain things that they have to find, kind of figure out and make work for them.
Very much so.
So what a great chop talk here. We started off with a controversy and, you know, kind of segued into something that's still kind of tied in. It was a promo that was controversial. Now we're talking about promos. What an episode of Chop Talk for an inaugural episode.
Thank you so much, Mel. I very much enjoyed this show. So we will be back in roughly a week's time. Our filming schedule, it all gets shifted because of my work schedule, mainly. next time we'll be back talking about Stardom.
Finally.
A company that I am just starting to get into Stardom. Before a couple of weeks ago, my majority of Stardom was a match here, a match there, whenever a podcast would or a review show would recommend it. I have been getting heavy into it, and I'm a few days into the five-star Grand Prix, and we'll be breaking down the five-star Grand Prix along with a couple other shows that they have promoted during the five-star Grand Prix, which I didn't know they did.
Yeah. Yeah, they've had a lot of shows going on, man, and the stardom is really starting to explode in the same way that NJPW is, which I am endlessly happy for. And I'm assuming, based on what you're watching with the five star there, you are as well.
So far, so far, I am having a great time watching Stardom for Stardom Wrestling. I mean, I've been writing down so many questions I'm going to be asking you. So
I hope I can answer them.
Sorry, because I'm coming at it from a new fan perspective. I have lots of questions that you can answer for me. I know you can. They're not crazy in depth. Don't worry, but there's stuff that a new fan could really be asking with this company, and I have a few of them for you.
Excellent. Well, with that being said, we're going to end this episode of Chop Talk on Chop Talk. Get it out, Melball. We're going to finish off this episode of Chop Talk. I'm your Melball. That is your Andre. We will see you next week. Adios. Thanks for watching, everybody. If you want to follow us on our social medias, you can follow me at Collins Melball on Twitter.
You can follow me on Twitter at That Canada Guy.
You can follow myself on Instagram at Melball Collins.
You can follow me on Instagram at That Canada Dude.
And on YouTube, of course, you can follow us on Andre and Melball's Wrestling Talk. We're planning on uploading hopefully weekly. We're going to hope to schedule that appropriately.
You can check us out on Twitch, which will be starting soon. I'm going to be doing some gaming and stuff on there. And we will be doing live streaming of our upcoming show, Why Though, and doing some New Japan and hopefully some Stardom watch-alongs on Andre Melball on Twitch. And then you can also check out our good friend, Mike the Ref, at Backbreaker Video on YouTube. He has wrestling, gaming, so much different stuff on there. And then you can check him out every week on Twitch. He hosts the AEW Dynamite watch along on Twitch every Wednesday night at 6 p.m. Mountain Standard Time, start at the start of Dynamite, and you can check out all his gaming and everything else on there.
Thanks for watching again, guys.